Facilities that make this program possible are provided by the City of Highland Park. Programs are produced independently by members of the community. The City of Highland Park is not affiliated with the following program or the producers of public access programming and is not responsible for the content. The following program does not reflect the opinions of the City of Highland Park.
And welcome to Comments Current Events Roundtable. Today we have a very special guest, and our special guest is Stephen Rusnikoff. And I say special because he's the professor of law at DePaul University, and he's also the director of its Center for Jewish Law and Judaic Studies. And I want to welcome you, Professor Rusnikoff. I'll call you Professor Stephen. That'll be easier.
Stephen is fine.
To Stephen. And we have a lot to accomplish on the show today. And Steve and I had a little lunch together, and we went over something that I thought our viewers should know, because it's going to be, our show is The Rise of Anti-Semitism, but there's a lot of things that it takes in. One thing it takes in is what happened just recently at the United Nations, what's happening on our campuses, and the BDS movement, which is boycott, divestment, and sanctions. And we want to get to all these topics today. I hope we can. And if not, I invite you back for the second half of our show, because it's a lot to accomplish and a lot to explaining to our viewers of what all these things are. And because we're, you know, we're in the United States, and we sometimes don't hear what's happening, you know, in other countries. And it's kind of a shocking thing to find out on our campuses and how much anti-Semitism that's going on. I listed 40 colleges. I went and looked up on my computer, and apparently there's more, but I found 40 different universities that are that anti-Semitism exists, and it's very, very shocking. And I'm going to start with, before we start with the universities, I'd like to start out on what has happened just recently on the our administration and our the United Nations censure. Israel's government publicly accused the Obama administration Sunday of helping create and push the recently passed United Nations resolution condemning settlement activity. And then what happened was, at the United Nations, they came out with a vote and abstaining. Was that it? Abstaining the vote. And what does this all mean? Since most of us do not understand a lot what's going on in the United Nations, and what is that for Israel, and what is it happen? Why is it happening today?
So the United Nations has a General Assembly and has a Security Council. The General Assembly resolutions do not purport to have anything to do with Jewish, with American law or international law. Those resolutions are just opinions of the Assembly. The Security Council, by contrast, it can pass resolutions which, at least on their face, purport to be statements about international law. They can do that in one of two ways. In one way, they can pass resolutions that actually have enforcement measures attached to them, and they can also do it the second way, where there's no enforcement measures explicitly attached to them. So what happened is there are 15 members of the Security Council. Five are permanent members. The other 10 rotate among the different members of the United Nations. The five permanent members each has a right to veto a resolution. So if they vote no to veto a resolution, then it doesn't matter if the vote is 14 in favor and one the veto against, the measure won't pass. Historically, there have been many anti-Israel an anti-Semitic, in my opinion, resolutions passed by the United Nations General Assembly. Rarely is any such resolution passed in the Security Council because the United States, at least, will veto it. That's the history. This time, there's a United Nations resolution, which was proposed without any enforcement measures attached to them, to it, was passed 14-0, and the United States did not vote for it. The United States did not vote against it or veto it. The United States abstained, and so it passed 14-0. This was a very, very unusual action by the United States. It knew that by its abstention was going to cause the measure to pass. It knew that it certainly knew the issues as well as anybody else would know the issues. There's certainly no particular reason to abstain, not to take a position yes or no, unless for political reasons they preferred the measure to pass, but they always reserved the right to say, we didn't vote for it. But they certainly were instrumental through its abstention to having this measure passed. And it's a very negative resolution. It will not promote peace in the Middle East. It does not promote further negotiations towards peace. It incorrectly says that the settlement activity violates international law. It's an incorrect statement of international law. One of my law school professors, Eugene Rostov, former Undersecretary of State, was one of the people involved in the drafting of important legal documents with respect to this, and his writings make it clear that the settlements are not illegal. There's certainly many more current and more recent professors of law who have said the same thing, experts in international law. What happens is the politicians throw around words like occupation, and they have or apartheid or genocide with no understanding of what the historical or legal meanings attached to those terms are, and it just inflames opinions. It will embolden the people who are militants on the Arab side, and it will infuriate people who are to the extreme sides of in the Israeli side, and it won't help anything.
Why is it there's so much on the settlements? Because, you know, actually we were talking earlier that the Palestinians, if they want to move with the Israelis on the settlements, they could buy a home or build a home or whatever, and they could live in the settlements as well. Why can't, you know, in the United States, we live next door to Christians, we live next door to Jewish people, we live next door to Muslims, we live, you know, all kinds of religions. And why can't they, you know, move next, you know, if they want to buy a home there, why can't they move in?
There's the dispute in the Middle East was long before there were any settlements. The problem in the Middle East fundamentally is the Arab refusal to recognize the existence of Israel, even within any geographical boundary. As is well has been often said by people wiser than me, which is by basically almost anybody, that you know there won't be peace in the Middle East until the Arab leadership want a Palestinian state, to construct a Palestinian state more than they want to destroy the Israeli state. The whole problem with, for example, the refugees was caused by a war perpetrated by the Arab sides in 1948 and perpetuated. I don't know if you realize that, for example, in many Arab countries, someone who is identified as a Palestinian is proscribed from getting a license to practice certain professions, maybe prescribed from being able to vote, and so on. I mean, it's to perpetuate this problem. So the settlements, it's what the Arab leadership wants to stop, and so they say that that's the obstacle to peace. It's not the obstacle to peace. The obstacle to peace is the indoctrination of kids throughout all of the Arab schools that they should hate Jews, that they should kill Jews, they should aspire to kill Jews, not just Israelis, but Jews internationally.
But now the Arab, the Arab Israeli, that's different, correct? The Arab, the people that live in Israel, the Arabs that live in Israel, they live in Tel Aviv.
When I say the Arab leadership, I'm talking about the Arab leadership in the West Bank and in Gaza.
No, I know that. But I was just saying about the Arab Israelis, you know, they seem to vote with the Israelis, don't they? They seem to take the side, they don't take the side very often of the Palestinian for some reason. They see, they have nice homes in Tel Aviv or in, you know, wherever they live in Israel proper.
Well, I don't know. It's difficult to generalize about that. But I, you know, first of all, there's the Arab Christians. Mm-hmm. The Arab Christians are joining the IDF. The Arab Christian leaders speak out very much in favor of the State of Israel, even at risk of very serious personal danger. And similarly, the Arab Muslims who are living in Israel, mm-hmm. right? It's difficult for them to speak out, because it would be extremely risky for them.
You know, we were talking about, this is going also, we're going to go, because of this, the settlements, that's where the boycott, divestment, and sanctions are taking place with the other countries, because they feel that the Palestinians are not, that they're second-class citizens. Is that, that's the reason why the BDS movement is so popular, you know, in the European countries?
The BDS movement is not designed to stop settlements. The leaders of the BDS movement...
To stop selling Israeli products.
No, but what I mean is that the very leaders of the BDS movement, including Barghouti, who was actually educated in an Israeli university, he's the leader of the BDS movement, he calls quite explicitly for the elimination of the entire state of Israel. He said that if we got rid of the settlements, that wouldn't be the end of it. If there were no settlements, mm-hmm. if we went back to the 67 borders, that wouldn't be the end of it. He calls for the complete destruction of Israel. So they're using BDS as just one tool to try to help destroy Israel. It's not designed to deal with the settlement issue.
But the people that in this area that uses the BDS, you know, that understand, they don't understand that.
They're
tools.
They think it's about
Israeli products. And so, but one of the things that they don't understand, and I kept saying that I think it's important that the Palestinians really speak out, that when you curb, when you put the BDS, which is the boycott of Israeli companies, of Israeli products, a lot of Palestinians are working in the factories and working for Israelis. And when they do the BDS, they're losing their jobs. When those factories and those products are closed down, these people, you know, that they're trying to, you know, the other side of it is trying to bring up and saying that, you know, the Palestinians deserve better, they're ruining their jobs. They're actually eliminating their jobs.
It's clear that you're right, that the BDS movement does not help the plight, day-to-day plight of Palestinians. It doesn't. As you say, SodaStream moved out, they lost jobs. People mm-hmm. worked for SodaStream. Other companies, they're mostly employing Arabs, and they're Palestinian Arabs, and they're losing their jobs. But the truth is, you have to understand the mindset of the people who are leading this movement. That's their objective is not to better the day-to-day life of Palestinians. Their objective is to destroy the state of Israel. BDS stands, as you said, probably stands for boycott, divest, and sanction. And it's both, it's not just economic, but it's also political and it's also academic. So for example, the idea is to isolate Israel, to make it a pariah state, and this UN resolution does contribute to that because it's essentially with all of the illegal, criminal, non-humanitarian, but humanitarian abuses throughout the world, what they do is they focus on Israel, and they don't focus on the terrorist actions by the Palestinians, the killing of innocent people by the Palestinians, but they focus on the settlements, which is a not violent activity, even if it were illegal, but it's, as I said, it's incorrect to say that it's in violation of international law. But they focus on that, and they say that Israel is in violation of international criminal law. It's making it a pariah state. Academics, for example, if you are an Israeli academic, you suffer a boycott. You suffer persecution. It doesn't matter if you're in Tel Aviv, which is certainly not a settlement. Although, from the point of view of some of the Arab leadership, all of Israel is a settlement, right? Illegally occupied territory. But if you are from Tel Aviv University and you refuse to specifically espouse the BDS doctrine, you can be refused. Someone will say that they won't review your paper. If you need to print papers in journals, you have to have them peer-reviewed by other academics. So they refuse to review your paper, or they'll refuse it adversely. They'll review it adversely. If you want to be a member of an editorial board of a journal, you can be denied membership. You can be denied opportunities to speak at international conferences. So
they have done that in the United States too. You have Israeli speakers coming in, and they are not allowed to speak at American universities.
At American universities, there are legal aspects, legal measures that can be taken, but unfortunately, in America, they disrupt violently sometimes the attempt to have a pro-Israel program. It happened most recently, I think, in University of Minnesota, perhaps. I know it happened at University of Texas. I know that happens at Irvine.
I could speak for it because it happened. I was in one of your classes, and they were starting to make all kinds of, you know, people came in and they were kind of almost boycotting the speaker. They wouldn't allow the speaker to speak. As soon as the speaker would speak, it was a little scary until security came in. So I felt what these people must be feeling, and kids and students, what they're feeling at the universities.
Well, let me tell you the event that you talked about, which was really the one event that we had this kind of trouble. We had it because we had two speakers. One was an attorney who prosecuted people civilly for their connections with terrorist activity, but the other was a U.S. attorney who was criminally prosecuting at least 9 relatively local residents for alleged criminal activity in terms of providing material support to a terrorist organization. And some of those individuals, I believe, made it a Facebook event to come and disrupt our program. That was unanticipated. We've then put protocols in place to deal with that type of problem in the future. But I should mention to you, what you saw as a disruption that in Chicago, in our program at DePaul, was unbelievably tame compared to the type of organized, violent disruptions mm-hmm. that happen routinely on the West Coast and sometimes in the East Coast. At Irvine recently, there was a young woman who not only was she blocked from going into a program, but she was followed to her car. She was left in tears, had to call 911 security to be escorted home. The Jewish or pro-Jewish, not all the pro-Jewish people are Jewish, of course, but the Jewish and pro-Jewish people who were in the program had to be escorted out by police to be protected from the mob that was outside. So the problems on campus can be mm-hmm. actually very severe. I should mention that anybody who wants to know about what is happening on campus there's a wonderful website called from the Amcho Initiative, and they can you can go there and see a list by college throughout the nation of the different events that have taken place, incidents with dates and details. It's a very good website, the Amcho Initiative.
I mean, I listed 40 different colleges, and in fact, we were just even talking about DePaul has an annual fall festival of resistance highlighting Israeli occupation, which is a BDS movement that was defeated at DePaul, by the way. It was defeated, which was good. So, you're at DePaul. I know University of Chicago had a problem at the University of Chicago, Northwestern University, Students for Justice and to promote BDS activity. And there were so many other schools. There was one in I mean, there's 40 of them. University of Illinois has a steady stream of attempts to demonize and delegitimize Israel. Last year, the menorah at the school Chabad House was vandalized with strong swastikas and strong, but they have a strong grassroots pro-Israel movement, which supports Jewish leadership. So what? How do these students? Let me ask you this: how do they handle when they have anti-Semitism, or the Chabad House gets defaced or something? What can they do? What can students do? And who could help these students as well?
Well, let me just make one thing clarify. Yeah. One thing. The truth is that DePaul, unfortunately, after initial failures to pass BDS resolutions, the student body in a referendum was able to pass a referendum in favor of BDS. The student government at Loyola voted for BDS. The student government at Northwestern voted for BDS. The student government at the University of Chicago voted for BDS. The three of those were just this year in the spring. And I should say that at Northwestern, they've had a series of vandalism, anti-Semitic vandalism.
So what can the students do? What can people do about this?
Well, what people have to do, what the Jewish community has to do, is work on kids before they get to college. Do you have to work on things before college, at college, and afterwards? But before college, they have to educate their kids about Judaism and about the narrative. I teach college students. I'm at the College of Law, and yet I find some students don't know anything about the Vietnam War. The Vietnam War. They don't know about it. Mm-hmm. Korean War. They don't know about Korea. Korea. I mean, we heard the word Korea. What happened in terms of 1948, what happened before 1948, the whole history of Aliyah to Israel, the fact that the Jews came and it was a wasteland, the first Aliyah to Israel was 1882 or so, and it was a wasteland. There weren't many Arabs living there. There was no Palestinian nation. There was never a Palestinian nation. In 1948, when Israel was created, the Arab complained that they were really part of Syria. Nobody ever complained that this was a Palestinian nation with a Palestinian government. But what nobody knows about the history, no one knows about the Pell Commission, where the Arabs and Jews were offered a divided area, the Jews a small area, the Arabs a large area, and the Jews said yes, and the Arabs said no. In 1948, the partition, the Jews said yes, the Arabs said no.
Yeah, but Steve, but a lot of people don't know, a lot of the kids don't know this, but it's good to educate them before, but this is happening on the campus now. What do they do? Maybe people like you, and to get together with somebody that does, that maybe is an attorney in the Palestinian, that you can work with people, they can get onto these campuses and talk about what the movement really is, how it can really hurt not just Israelis but Palestinians, as we talked before. But somebody has to get on these campuses and talk, and it has to be twofold. It has to be with two different people: a professor of Israeli studies and a professor maybe of Arabic studies, and the two together they can form an alliance together and maybe talk to these kids.
Well, you have to understand that the people who are the primary organization of students that promotes BDS is Students for Justice in Palestine, SJP. SJP has an official policy, just as the promoters of BDS have an official policy of non-normalization. They will refuse to speak with us. They will refuse to have a debate with us. They will refuse to sit on a panel with us. But they will will disrupt our programming, refuse to participate in the programming, and then complain if we try to object to some of their programming.
So, what do you think is the solution to this?
Well, there's not a solution. There's no silver bullet or golden bullet. But what there are a number of things we have to do. As I said before, college. I propose that there should be a just as there was a birthright right? A birthright program to Israel.
Right.
I believe, and I'm not going to impinge on their patent or the copyright, but I believe there should be an educational birthright. I think we should have a college a course for high school graduates, especially, but not only, for those high school graduates who come from secular high schools who don't really know much about Israel. We should have a 4-credit free college credit course for these students, as many as we can convince to take it. We can teach them through distance learning, we can teach them in person, but get them educated. Education is the single most genuine Jewish solution to problems. And the failure to have this education is really the root problem that we have.
They should take the Christian students along with them so they can understand what's happening. Sometimes the Christian students are much more educated in what's going on, you know.
But in terms of history, I think the problem is universal. Young modern kids just don't know much about history. Mm-hmm. Everything is instant information. If Siri doesn't tell them about it, they don't know about it. But I do want to tell you that we do programs on campus, and there are other groups, important groups, Stand With Us does programs here. David Project does programs on the West Coast. We do programs. We have programs also for attorneys and professionals. We don't only focus on anti-Semitism. We have programs. We've had programs on child abuse, sexual child abuse. We're having program next in February on the sexual trafficking of women. I mean, we had program in spring on the persecution of Christians throughout the Middle East. Mm-hmm. Christians. We had 4 Christian speakers, 3 of whom had risked their life on the ground in Iraq. But certainly we want to fight anti-Semitism, and we do it through education. That's what we have to do.
So that's how. And then what do you do with the existing schools that, you know, now? What do you do? That's before they come in, but now they're at the university.
So for example, we've had speakers talking about international law, about the integrity of Israel's borders. We've had speakers we had a program in Lincolnwood 2 weeks ago, or December 13th, with respect to anti-Semitism in international organizations such as the United Nations and others. We've had programs with professors. We've had programs with Israeli dignitaries. We've had programs with other kinds of people. So we do it on campus and outside of campus. We have programs at synagogues. And we're willing to go to different parts of the community. We just want to get the message out.
And also, there's the new anti-Semitism. There's a law out too, isn't there?
There's a proposed law.
Yeah.
It's anti-Semitism. Well, there is no definition of anti-Semitism. Ironically, the United.